Welcome all this afternoon to my session Infuse my Eye into Embraco. And I'm going to talk about Microsoft Cognitive Services extending Embraco. My name is Henk Boeman, and I'm a developer from the Netherlands. But on my business card, it says Cloud Architect, so I'm a developer that can also draw nice Visio images and talk to customers. If anyone wants to reach me, you can go on Twitter, LinkedIn, GitHub. You will actually find the source code I'm going to show you today. And if you want to read more about cognitive services or how to use them, you can read my blog. There are some long tutorials on how to do it yourself. I'm also organizer of the Global AI Bootcamp. We're going to do that in, hopefully, a lot of countries on the 13th of October. So if you have a venue or run a user group, contact me and we may be able to set up an event together on that date. So like I said, I like to make software and I like to make something that is useful, like Embraco, keep the experience smooth and simple. So that is where Microsoft Cognitive Services come in. They really can make things easier for you and take a lot of work out of your hands. So cognitive services are able to help you understand what input is coming in, at least in my demos. So if images come in, it can understand what is on those images and it can act accordingly. So these cognitive services are divided in six main areas. Vision, to see and understand what is on images. Language, to understand what that language actually means. So what the user means. Speech, to talk it out and get the speech to text in. Knowledge, I always call it like Ankarta on the cloud, Ankarta in the cloud. And search, if you think it is a good idea to hook your website up to Bing search, you can do that too because all Bing's APIs are available. And then there is one cool thing about cognitive services. The Microsoft Research Lab has some demos in preview, so you can access that through the Cognitive Services Labs. And there you can find Project Prague and Project Cusco, all very nothing saying names. So you can really see what they're trying to work before the product is released. So these cognitive services are very easy to implement. If you want to implement, let's say, emotion detection on images, you just need these four lines of .NET code and of course include a NuGet package. So you make the client, do a request, and you get back a strongly typed object, which you can use in your code. You create them in Azure. So you create new cognitive services, select the API type you want, click create, and you see here a dashboard with the requests. So it only takes like 1 or 2 minutes to set up this thing. So let's start with the computer vision API. So you create this vision API, and to this vision API, you send an image. If you send this image, it will describe the image, a man flying through the air while riding a skateboard. So that is done with the API call, and you get that sent as back. So it can describe what is on the image. But it can also, It is not always that good. If you put in this image, it will say a man water skiing behind a boat. So it is not that good, but it also gives you back a lot of tags with a confidence score, and those tags are more accurate. Besides the tags, it can also give you other features back if it is adult content or racy content. That racy content means that it's somehow debatable if you want it on your website. It can identify what type of color is used. And it can tell you if it is a clip art image or a drawn image or a photo. So before, if you get the image in your system, you can really pre-filter already if you want that image in your system. It can also detect celebrities on the image, and it will even tell you where they are on the image. And it also detects our king. And I had to show him today because it is King's Day in Holland and everyone is celebrating his birthday. So it can do with a lot of celebrities over a lot of countries. You can also detect objects. And you see here that it just tells you which object it is with the confidence score, but it doesn't tell you where the object is. And that is because this is a classification thing, so it just gives a probability of what it sees on the image. So it tries to classify it in certain categories. It can also read text in images, so it can just tell you where the text is and what it says. So you see the bounding boxes, it can bound the sentences and it can bound the words individually. And that you also get back in a nice JSON object where you can just loop through the sentences and see what is on the image. And it can, since a few months, it can also do handwritten detection. But it is a little bit buggy. You really have to put the image in quite straight. And with the normal text, it can be like vertical or horizontal. It doesn't really matter. It even will tell you the angle where it's found in the text. So I've implemented this API in Umbraco. So now we can see, so when you upload an image in the media library, it will just call this API and it will fill in all the fields for us. So I've extended the media type with some properties. So we go to the first demo, the computer vision demo. And there we see now, let's take a doc. It is uploading it, it is running it now through the API. So, and it is back. And there we are. So here we see the standard Umbraco screen with the upload image, the width and the height. And here I made a tab computer vision. And here it is the description that we got back from the API. We see it is not adult content, it's not racy content. It didn't detect any celebrities, no landmarks. And it gave us a lot of tags. So we can even make like a search on those tags if we, for instance, put it in Azure Search. So we pick like another image. That is here with, let's say with two things on it. Let's see if it's becoming better. So here we see it detected the celebrity. It didn't detect the Eiffel Tower for some reason. It doesn't do both at the moment. So it detected the celebrity and it also tagged it. Put it there. And we see the tags and the computer vision thing. So that is what you can do. And that is just 5 lines of code in the, if you save your media file, you call the saving media controller object. Let me see, I will show you some code that will clarify it up a bit. And here we have it. So we see it in the application event handler. That was the word I was looking for. You can just extend the media saving. And there you just do a call, and it is just this code. And this code is also on GitHub, like you saw. So you can just copy it. And there is also an Umbraco package that will just put this code for you in and create all the properties automatically. But sometimes that is not enough. Now we saw that we get back like tags like water, boat, car. So sometimes you want to be a bit more specific on what you get back for text because you have your own product catalog or you want to do something more specific. So that is why when the custom vision service comes in, and in the custom vision, you can create your own custom image classifier. And again, it is very simple. You just upload a bunch of images which you tag, like we're going to use stickers for this demo. You tag them as sticker A, sticker B. You take like around 30 images from the object you want, from all different sizes, all different angles, and very especially all different backgrounds. Otherwise it is going to classify your background instead of your object. You upload them, you tag them, you hit the train button, and an endpoint is created for you. Now you can easily test it to have some other photo of the same image, you run it against your model, and you should get back a tag. You don't get back where the object is in your in the image, because it is a classifier and it doesn't know where the object is. It will just give a probability score to the tags. You will see it later. So when you've done that, you can expose it in three different ways. You get an API for free, which you can just send images to, and you get back the tags. Or you can export it to CoreML or a TensorFlow object. And CoreML can run on the iPhone, so you can use it in Xamarin and you can use it in Swift. And Android, you can also use it. You use it for your Android things. I don't develop for Android, so I have no idea what tooling they use for that. But you can do so, you can export it to those models, and that goes very fast. So you actually can run the model locally without a connection to the cloud on your devices. And it is very, very fast. Even on iPhone 6, it runs very smooth. So let us create our own image classifier here at the moment. So you go to customvision.ai. That is the website where it all happens. You log in with a Microsoft account, and you can do two things. If you just want to play around with it, it is free and you don't need an Azure subscription. If you want to have like a commercialized model and have lots of requests and lots of throughput, then you need an Azure subscription and you have to pay for it, of course. You can switch on the right, you can switch directory, so you can switch to an Azure subscription where you're built. So when you create a new project, you just have to put a name, description, and you can choose a domain. And the domain, the names are quite self-explanatory, but the only ones that work for exporting are when it is compact. So if you want to have a CoreML model for your iPhone, you have to choose one of these compact things. These domains, they just come in by Microsoft. It just delivers every week or 2 weeks, there is suddenly a new domain. So Microsoft is still training these domains, and they will use your images for that. So be careful with uploading sensitive information, because Microsoft will use it to make their models better. So I'm not going to upload like 100 images. So I have a small program that can upload those images for me, because you can train this model from code. So if you're making applications that have to be self-learning, you can just feed the input images through an API to your model and retrain your model to get smarter. So, of course, you need API keys. So I need here the training key. And this is just a very simple command line application that is just now just uploading the images and tagging them and then eventually training the model. And these are all the stickers that we saw in the previous slides. So if internet is working with us, it will be done soon. There are only like 8 stickers, so we're almost there. So in the meanwhile, we can already go and see that our project is created. You see here. So this you can also all do by hand, but it is of course nicer to have a program doing that for you. Now here we see all kind of stickers uploaded and in all different sizes, in all different angles and with some different background. And as you see, they're not very good pictures, not very sharp. This is made with a small iPhone. Is it training or is it done? It is still training. So when you've uploaded all the images and tagged it, of course you have to hit the train button. And then when that is done, you see here how accurate your model is. And the higher the score, the better your model can predict the right answer. So on top you see a quick test button. You can go there, browse a local file, Braco AI, custom vision. So here were my trainings images. And here are my control images, so we upload this. And we see that it is, thought, hey, it is a sticker, and it tagged it as a C# sticker, because that is what I tagged it with the sample images. So also this model is available through an API. So it's just a simple API call, again, from Umbraco. So before we do that, we need to get the prediction URL, and there we see our prediction key. And you need the project ID, which is not there, but is here under settings. So we get that project ID. I've made a settings note in Umbraco where I can easily put it, but this would be somewhere to put in your web config or your application settings in Azure. And if we now upload a sticker to there, like a coding sticker, computer vision. We see that it is tagged it as a sticker, and as coding is my birthright, what is actually there. And we can see what it has done. Under the tab predictions, we can see here how it has scored the images. So this is actually the image we just uploaded in Umbraco. We can see it here back, and we see how it has classified it. And if classified it wrong, we can give it the correct tag, so it will classify it the next time right if it sees something. So you can make your model better and better and better over time with user-generated input. So you don't need to have your complete training set when you start. You need just like a small one, and then it can grow through your users. So that's it. I forgot one thing with the previous demo. So what I saw, it can also, like the computer vision, it could also detect text on images. So that is also what my demo does. So if I upload an image with text on it, we go to this tab. We here see the text nicely in the lines. And we see here how much percentage of the image is covered with text. So if you have like a system where you don't want people to write ads or things on the images, you can use this API call to calculate how much text is on the image and then automatically reject the image. That is something that works in our Dutch eBay. If you upload and put your phone number on your image, because you normally have to pay for your website and your phone number, then it just denies the image. So you can use this in a smart way in your web applications. So now we can describe the image, tag the image, identify our own objects in the image, and even detect how much percentage is covered with text. So next we have the face API, because besides that, we saw already that it can detect celebrities, but it can also detect faces. And the face API describes faces. It can tell you if your face is smiling, or if your gender is male. It has a bounding box, and it can detect 27 different landmarks. You see all the red dots is what makes for this cognitive services, makes this face unique. It can tell you if you have glasses on or what your age is. Can also detect emotions. And if you put this one in it, I tried with lots of pictures, it will always show that he is angry. Try it at home. So let me show you a quick demo of what else this API can give back. I've created a small UWP app that should show me if the light is not too much. Stop. Perfect. So we see on the left side that it detects age, gender, how much I smile, what glasses I have. It's trying to classify which color my hair is, and I think in this photo it is quite right at saying that black is the right color. I have a beard accordingly. So it will give you also your sideburns, your mustache, and your beard. It will tell you if you wear makeup. It will tell you if you have lip makeup or eye makeup. Those are the two things. And it can detect if you have glasses or a hat. And I'm thinking that they will expand it more and more and more. It can even detect if you wear swimming goggles. That's quite cool. On the right side, we see the emotions API. That one is included for free in the face API. So you get that back for every face for free when you do a call to that. And then below are also a few interesting settings. And with these things below, you can really make sure that the image you get in is sufficient enough to do face detection on. So if you want to have portraits or anything, or you have a camera feed, you can really, if it is underexposed, you can just deny the picture for further training. So you get a lot back in one API call. This is just one API call sending one image, and that is what you get back. So you can use it also for face identification. So now we saw that it can detect faces in images, it can do up to at least 40 faces in one image. But it can also use to compare different faces and tell, hey, this is Hank. So you can register, before you have to do that, you have to register a face. And registering faces happens in person groups. So the first call you do is create a person group. Let's say Umbraco Germany group. In that group, we create a person, let's say Hank. And that person you create just with the person group ID and a person name. And that name is just random what you want. And then you can start adding faces to that person. The more faces you have, the better the system will recognize you. And that can be done with an image stream or just give some URLs and it will download the image from the internet. And then you have to train. And since a while, there is also a retrain option, so it doesn't take so long. Then if you want to identify the face, you call the detect function. It's also an API call. And that is the same thing that we saw with my face. But that gives back like temporary face IDs. So all the faces have a temporary ID. And those IDs you give to the identify method. And then it will look up which person it is. And you get back the person ID. And that person ID you can use in your own applications. That is what you store. So how does it work if you put this in Umbraco? So I use the members, and I want my members to be detected in the media library on images. So when you create a new member, with, of course, it needs to have a profile picture. So you have to create a field where the profile picture is in. So on that member, on some member saving, you create that person in the face API. So you get back a person ID. Then you add the picture and you get back a face ID. You train the member group and you store the person ID and the face ID in your member. That's it. So it is one call, or three calls you have to do, and you store the output in your members. Then, from the other side, if you want to detect them, you upload the image to the media library. You call the onMedia saving file. You call detect faces to get the temporary face IDs. Then you call identify the face. You get back the person IDs. You look up those person IDs in your members. And you store the members in your media file. So just a few API calls in the onSaving thing, and it will handle that all in the the background. So of course I've done that in Umbraco to show you. That is here. Here I have members and I've made. I needed to have a family because I needed to have multiple people on the images. So we have the modern family, and we have the 70s show family. Yeah. So I've already uploaded most of the images because we don't want to see that all. So here we see a lot of things we get back from the photo. She is wearing makeup. And here we see the person ID. And that is the connection to the Microsoft Face ID. That is what you get back and what you can look up in your members. So if you now upload an image. Face API. Let's do a 70s show with the wallcast. So upload it, it will also do all the other custom vision and computer vision things. And looking up members by person ID is still a bit slow. If you now go to face ID, we see that it looked up all the people in that image through the face API and from the members. And so these are actually tagged members. To show you that it actually works, we have here a picture of modern family. With the whole family, so we should expect 5 people to be tagged. And we see that it only has tagged 4. So we can go to the members here, create a new member. Add a profile picture that we already put in the faces folder. We're missing Haley. Submit. Press save. No. Of course, Haley needs a login. Needs a secure password. So now the post has happened and we see that we got the person ID back. The model is retrained and it had to run the detection. Just the click on save did that. If you now go to our family, you click save again. The thing should be that she is also detected under the Face API tab. And it is Umbraco, so this multi-picker you have to refresh by re-clicking the node. So here we see that it is now detected. Just by a few simple API calls, we have face detection in Umbraco with members and the media library. No, we don't want to store that password. So then another few handy things in Umbraco. You can do text analytics, it is also an API. You send a string with text and it will tell you if it is negative or positive. It will tell you which language it is and it will extract the most useful phrases from it. So a lot of easy keywords. There is also a translator API, which can translate from and to 52 languages. So you just send the string to there and you get back the translated text, and that goes very, very fast. And these are the languages it can do, and it can actually do Klingon. So what I've made in Umbraco to show is a comment section, because you don't want to moderate every comment, but you want to reject the comments that are very negative automatically. So if you go here, you go to content, I've created a comments node, and what it does is, when you save a text, it will detect the language and translate it to several other languages. And we'll give you the sentiment, that is a score between 0 and 1, how positive the comment is, and extract the most important key phrases. And let's hope Umbraco will load. It will be nice. And there we are. So I have here a few comments, but I'm just going to create a new comment. Let's say Hank, my name, and then this hotel is an awful place. Don't go here. No, I spelled this wrong. Don't. So that is what you could get back in from your website, and you store it in Umbraco. So when you save it, it detected that the sentiment is 0.02. So it is correct that it is a negative comment. Detected that the language is English, but it also translated it now to all these languages. So if anyone wants to pronounce this, this should be the thing. And it in German. So that you saw how fast it went. Just one click, it did like 6 API calls and it translated it automatically. So you can also do some other fun things with the translation and the language detection. So I've created also a menu reader. And sometimes you have menus when you're on holiday, which you want to read. So here, if you now click on this, it now just really uploaded, detected where all the strings were, draw boxes around it. And if you click on it, it will send it to the text translation API, and you will get it back in Dutch and English in this case. And sometimes you really find funny things in menus. So if you go here to this menu, you think this is a nice menu. So you click on this text and then you get this back. And you think, okay. Then you close and then you read the next line. Then this is there. So sometimes, but it is very easy to make this application. I think this costed me like four hours to make by just a few REST API calls. So we continue with the next thing. So then we end up with LUIS, Language Understanding System. And we've seen already a bit in like two keynotes that it is used by bots to understand what language is coming in. So I'm going to zoom in a bit deeper how this LUIS thing actually work. So what it can do is you can send a sentence to LUIS in natural language, so how you would be talking normally. And LUIS extracts and maps it to an intent. And an intent can be like, in this sample, can be comments. So every sentence that is related to comment should be mapped to the intent comment. So my application can handle on the word comment instead of all the other sentences. So do I have new comments? Are there new comments? All those things mean the same. So in our applications, it should also point to the same method that is invoked. And it can do one more other cool thing, and that it can use entities. And entities are like variables in the sentence. So in this thing, I want to ask, are there negative comments or are there positive comments? So I still want to be mapped to the intent comments and get if it is negative or positive in a variable. So I can make an if or switch statement on that. And you can do that, of course, with much more intent. So put the red light on in the downstairs room. And you can make all those red lights downstairs. You can make entities from. So that is how you can make the more natural language. So what I've done, I've hooked this chatbot up to Umbraco. I didn't have the chance of using Umbraco headless. So I had to make my own Umbraco API that handles some things for me. So we saw that they were running a web client where they were typing in. So that can also be online in a text client or can be in Azure. That is also a web tester. So it is just a texting. So there you ask, are there any comments? It comes up in your web app bot. And your web app bot can be a bot framework, but it can also be any other thing. I would recommend to do the bot framework because it handles a lot of things with state and session and those things for you. It can also remember the user context so you can actually build a conversation. So it's very easy to get started. The web bot sends that string to Lewis and Lewis gives back an intent. And so your web app bot doesn't have to know about the whole sentence, only about the word comment or the intent. Then you just do an API request to Umbraco API and you get back. There are 3 comments. And that is what the web app bot will send back to the web chat. But you can also put an invoke with Cortana on it. And that can, yeah. You're sweet. Set your name. So you can also ask it to Cortana and then the whole same thing happens as when you ask it through text, through a web chat. So Cortana is the Microsoft Digital Assistant. It's been around for quite some time, but now they're with all the chatbots and the whole chatbot revolution coming in, she's becoming more relevant. And the main difference between Cortana and the rest is that it is really hooked up in your Microsoft suite. And it really travels with you. You can have it on your mobile phone, it is on your computer, it is on the thing, and it all connects through your Microsoft Passport to the same kind of things. So when you start doing that, you have to ask, hey Cortana, that thing activates Cortana. Then you have skills, and skill is the name of your bot, let's say. In this case, it is called Chief Unicorn. So you ask Chief Unicorn, and then you say the sentence that will actually come into Lewis. Like that is the same thing. And then you, if you program it right, you stay in the context of your skill, and you don't have to all the time say, hey Cortana, ask Chief Unicorn for every sentence, then you can just have a conversation with it. And that works from your desktop, that works from, if you were an American, it would work on your iPhone. Not in Europe, and it works from the Cortana speaker. If you put your laptop, that it uses United States culture and things. So it has to think you're in America. If you say you're in Holland, then it doesn't work. So I have a demo that I can show you for invoking this Cortana thing. So this I will show you later in Azure how to create it. Yes. Say hello because you always greet the bot. And there it.
Can you close the window?
Yes, I will close the window. Graag gedaan. So and then I can ask her. Are there any new comments? And then she will tell me, yeah, you have 3 new comments. I think 2 of them are negative because, of course, we had the whole sentiment detection there. And shall I read the last one? No, don't do that. That's clear. What can I do for you? Are there any negative comments? And of course there are, because we just created one. And shall I read the last one? Yes. So then we get it back, and then we can invoke an action, what she actually has to do with it. And that is just an API call back to Umbraco that will either publish the comment or unpublish the comment. So that is with text. And now, bye. So that is what I made. And you can also do that with the Cortana speaker. And one thing about Cortana, it is not so friendly with Dutch or German accents. So let's hope she will recognize me today. Hey Cortana, ask Chief Unicorn, are there any new comments?
You have 3 new comments. I think 2 of them are negative. Shall I read the last one?
Yes.
Posted 5 days ago. I think this comment is negative. This hotel was very bad. Very dirty rooms and the staff was awful. The breakfast was nice. Shall I delete or approve this comment?
Approve.
Comment approved. Shall I read the next comment?
No.
That is clear. What can I do for you?
Goodbye.
Nice talking to you. Chief Unicorn out.
So that is something you can just very easily make. And making a Cortana skill on top of the bot framework is very, very, very easy. So the last demo is going to create one of these chatbots and show you how easy it is to do that. I'm not going to connect it to Umbraco, but you can all do an API call, I think. So everyone, if you're familiar with the Azure portal, you go to AI and Cognitive Services, you click Web App Bot. And you have to type in a lot of information. So we call this to Umbraco Germany, Nibot. We put it in a resource group. Maybe we'll put it a bit closer. If you have a look at the pricing, you can start for free. Then you can have 10,000 messages. So that I think is enough to really develop the bot. And otherwise it is 42 cents. For 1,000 messages, it has to process. So a bot can be becoming a bit expensive if it is really successful and lots of people start playing with it. You have to give it an application name because this also runs on top of an Azure application service, on an app service. So it is just MVC app that it will deploy to a web app and has a nice Azure portal skin around it where you can configure the bot. So you can choose a starting template. So we're going to choose a starting template that uses Lewis. So we will be able to have those intents up and down. We also want Lewis to run in West Europe. We will choose actually a fast app service plan for that. Put your application insights off, because otherwise it will crash when you create it. You can always add it later. Click confirm that they will use every input you send to Microsoft Cognitive Services that are in preview. You get a disclaimer that they will use your information and your content to train the bots better. And then we click create. And what it does now is it registers in the background, a Lewis application for us. It creates an app service plan and it installs the bot framework with the template on it, which we can use. And that can take a maximum of a minute, but we will see that it will take a bit longer. So in the meanwhile, I go to Lewis. I have to sign in. And there we can see some more of the interface of Lewis. And here we see that it is deploying, so that is a good sign. So all these preview versions, all those websites from Lewis.ai, dev.botframework.ai are all not very, very, very fast. So you need to have a lot of patience when you develop it, and it can also, the interface changes all the time. So you see that it already has created our bot or our Lewis application. And it is still creating it. So we can have some fun already with this. So here it has created already 4 intents for us. So you can already out of the box say cancel, it can greet you, it can do help, and it can also map to none, that it doesn't know what to do with it. So if you create a new intent, let's say we're going to make something that can turn lights on and off, turn on, off. So now we've created our intent, and now we're going to give it some sample sentences that it can use. So turn the light on, turn the light off, put the light on, turn on the light. So now we have a few things, and you can of course go further and you can always retrain it. So now we just, but now you've seen that we have all the sentences, we don't have any entities yet, and we really want to get those on and off as a variable inside our application. So we can go and create an entity and we call it state. And then if we go to our intent, we can just click on it and say, this is our entity state. This is our entity state. This is our. Then you click train. And it is a queue. So sometimes you're the first in the queue and it goes very fast. Sometimes you have to wait a while. So we click train, or you can click test. And then you can just test what the outcome would be. So if you say turn on the light, you see that it is, we can click inspect. We see that it is mapped it to turn off and it filtered out the entity on. And that's how it works also with turn off the light, inspect. And it didn't do it. That is not good, we have to retrain it, I think. So now we can see when our bot is running. When this is real user input and it doesn't really match, you can improve the bot by review endpoint here, and then you can say you should map this to this intent, and you can actually click the entities. It doesn't work if you do it from test. And I exactly know why it is not working, because we have to publish it first. So you build it, you train it, you publish it. And if it is published, it should work. No, doesn't work. But then we just give it an extra sentence. Turn off the light. Weird, it doesn't work. Turn off the light.
You turn the light off. Light.
Turn off the light.
Turn off the light.
Turn off the light, yeah. It doesn't really matter for the demo, but here you can manage all the all the sentences, and you build and train it and make it better, and you have to have like at least 15 to 20 sentences to make it really smart and that it starts learning a little bit by itself. So that it can do a little bit of variations itself. So we're going to publish this thing, because the basic thing we want to do is that it works from Cortan. Our thing here is created. And here we can test it. And like any MVC application, it also the bot needs an app start. So we can say hello. And what the sample only does is give you back which intent it is mapped to, and it will say hello. That is the only thing it does. So if we dive a little bit into the code, then you can find it under build. You can open the online editor, but you can also download the sample code, put it in a Git repository, and deploy it on a normal way. You can use VSTS and everything, all your unit tests, all the tests, because it is just deploying a web application to an app service. But for now, we're just going to open the code, and there in that editor, we can actually do a .NET build. So we can really train the bot. So here we see it, we have a controller. When you come in, that is the message controller. And you get a free dialogues here. And this is where the magic happens. Here is the intent mapped to this task. And that you get all out of the box. So we're going to create a new intent, turn on, off. And we also do it here. And we just want to have this, save it. And here is a console, and you can just type build, and it will build the solution if I didn't make any typos. So first it will do a NuGet restore, and that always takes a while, and with NPM it will install all the build tools on it. But it's very easy for debugging, and especially when you use Cortana, you need to have like a bot in the cloud, otherwise it will not really connect to it. So when this is built, we should be able to at least get a response that we've reached our intent. I can't stand it. Yeah. Okay, it is done. So then we can go very easily back to the test. And you always greet the bot first. You wait, because it needs to have an app start. Okay, I will build it one more time, and then in the meanwhile show you how to expose this this bot to Cortana. Because with a Microsoft bot, you can expose it to different channels. And we've seen that it has some issues with the web chat at the moment. But you can also expose it to Cortana, to Microsoft Teams, to Skype. You can actually make like a bot that you can phone in Skype. And it can do other cool things like post things for you in Slack. And another nice thing is that Cortana can have your user context. If you give it permission to use your context, so your email or can read your agenda or other things, it can actually really notify and be an assistant, is what it is meant to do. And if this thing is built, I really want to try it one more time. But it is actually going to fail. No. So we're going to create a new channel for this Cortana device. Because it will actually work, but it will just not answer us. So click here. To register a bot for Cortana, like register a Cortana skill, you have to go to the knowledge store and make their company profile. So it's just like an app store. So you have to do that, click register, and it will automatically do that for you on the background if you have a company. And in the knowledge store, you can publish the bot to different stages. So it can first live only in your account, so like in my Microsoft Passport. So I am the only one that can interact with her, with the skill. You can send it to a group, and then you can publish it to the knowledge store where everyone can use it. And then Microsoft is also going to test your skill. So this is the same as with the Apple App Store. It can take a while for your skill to become publicly available for everyone. But it becomes available for you like straight away. So here we see that I have three bots, and here we see it is created to Umbraco bot. And like I said, you need a name for your bot to really communicate with it. So by default, it makes the name of your application. And no one can pronounce this quite well. So if you find the edit icon, then here you can take the name. So I always call it Christine to annoy my wife. Christine already exists in the marketplace, yeah. Then let's call it Lisa today. Save. So now it is here, and you see that instantly when I registered, it is created here. So to start doing that first, we can ask Lisa. Hello, yes, she will also not respond. Very well. Ask Lisa. We see that it now actually mapped to the Umbraco Germany bot here. And then it will ask permissions, because in the knowledge store you can also say which permissions your bot needs. So in this case we have selected non-permissions, so it will only receive the text I type. So we say, yeah, that is good. And now she will tell us that she is having an error. Oh. And here it magically works. That's cool. So it also works here. Hey Cortana, ask Lisa, hello. Sorry, it doesn't work like that because you need to add speaking capabilities to your bot. We just saw that I gave a text string to send. So you have to add, to make the response a bit bigger. This close. So you can make a response message, you can put in text. So this is exactly what we saw, the same code what we saw before. And you can add dot speak. So that is the only thing you have to do to add the speaking capabilities to your bot. Save it. And we'll hope it built correctly and a bit faster than the last time. Always quite. Yeah. So you see that testing a bot is always quite, takes a lot of time to every time you have to do that to. We're going to boot it up, see if it works. Hello. Always takes so long to test this thing. And then you wonder why it works in the web interface fast and here in the this console thing slower. Turn off the light. So the second time it always works. Hey Cortana, ask Lisa to turn off the light.
Turning the lights off.
Yes. So that is what I want to show you. So in, what is it? I think 10 minutes, you can create a Cortana skill, and the longest time you're busy with building the Excel program instead of programming. So that is the last thing I wanted to show you. So I've shown you six things which you can put in Umbraco. Computer vision for general object detection, custom vision to make it a bit more specific, face API for describing people, describing faces and identifying faces, emotion detection on faces, text analytics and text translation. Yeah, to for instance, see comments or automatically approve things, but to get sentiment out of it and translation, and Lewis to process natural language to intent and extract entities from that. And remember, it is just calling an API. Everything is just calling an API. So if you want to read more and have the code, it's all here, and more on my blog or Twitter. Thank you.